My name's Bray Grimes, and I'm from Yamaha Music Australia. And I'm here to welcome you to this special live event with Chris Bullock and Justin Stanton of Snarky Puppy. Today, we're going to present a pre-recorded presentation, which Chris and Justin have done due to a lot of restrictions. Also being in different parts of the world, Justin now being in Lisbon and Chris being in New York. So stick around to the end, though, because we do have a live Q&A after where Justin and Chris can answer your questions on some of the content, and feel free to reference back and use the chat to put some questions in for both Justin and Chris, and we'll relay them at the end of the presentation. For now, I'm going to pass it over to Justin and Chris, and please enjoy.
What up, Justin?
What's up, Chris?
How you doing?
I look like I'm lounging.
I think
How
you are.
How are you guys? hey guys, I'm Justin Stanton.
And I'm Chris Bullock.
Chris Bullock. And we're two of the five horn players of Snarky Puppy. And
is it five or we got more now? Have we gained more mass?
Have we gained more? I think everybody's gained mass over 2020.
Definitely.
Yeah, so Chris and I are here to just chat a little bit about kind of what we do in Snarky and what we've been working on since we've been at home a lot this year. And what else are we talking about today?
Anything and everything music related.
Yeah.
Creativity.
Yeah. You know, we're all spending a little bit more time at home, or a lot more time at home. So I think everybody's trying to do a little more recording at home, be a little bit more self-sufficient. So maybe we'll talk a little bit about how to get a good sound at home and kind of what we do on stage and at home to kind of expand the sonic horizons, so to speak.
Definitely. Speaking of being at home, what you been practicing, Justin?
What have I been practicing? Well, sort of switching gears between a lot of different stuff, you know, try to stay on the horn a lot. Also, been playing piano and practicing and writing. But in terms of things I like to focus on, trumpet on a daily basis, I'm doing just try to hit all the bases, you know, long tones and lip slurs and all that exciting stuff. But just try to keep it more of like I feel like the older I get, the more I like to think of that stuff as it's like a mental thing rather than like a physical thing. And it's more, the long tones and all that stuff are more about keeping my, keeping my head in the right place when I'm doing them rather than just sort of going through the motions. And I feel like that's an important way to sort of get my head right, not just playing music, but just throughout the day.
Yeah.
What about you?
Yeah. I same kind of stuff, you know, and it's like, it's funny. Like I think back, you know, 20 years ago or something like that, when I was like a teenager, and like those things that we hated to practice, like long tones and various, like, you know, daily kind of requirements if you want to move air through a horn like this or that.
Yeah.
And now I've like come to love it and really like cherish those moments. And it's like almost like become meditative in a way.
Yeah, I totally agree. You know? Yeah. And
like I love like having the, like choosing to take the time and like move some air and just listen to the sound and try and get inside of my sound. And like, the more I've done that over the years, like the more personal, and I feel like I've like developed the sound and it, and the way you can color it and change it, super fun.
Yeah, totally. It's almost like, yeah, it's like, as a kid, I totally understand. It's like that I feel like I was in such a hurry to get better that like, I felt like the key when I was young was to practice everything as quickly as I can, practice being able to play as high as I can. And it's like, once I'm still learning, but I feel like as I'm gradually learning to slow my practicing down and focus on, it allows me to focus on how I can really achieve an individual sound. Like you said, it's like sort of really get inside that. Not only like in an aural way, but I feel like also in a physical way, because it's like if I play a long tone and something's not feeling right, or if I play a lip slur and it's not feeling right, if I'm playing things too quickly, I'm gonna skate over it and potentially develop bad habits, right?
Yeah, yeah. And bad habits are great because then you learn how to recover from those bad habits.
Yeah, I mean, unless it's like 20 years too late, like some of the things I'm working through. But for any of you youngsters out there listening,
when I was the younger, like you were talking about, like it was always like higher, faster, louder.
Yeah.
Or maybe not louder, but maybe louder. I remember in like big band and marching band and all that.
Yeah.
Those, you know, it was like, I'm going to outblow everyone. And then you come to realize, wait a second.
Yeah, you played in marching band too. You get it. Like, yeah, it was always like, and trumpet's the worst. Like, it's the most jockish instrument, you know, and like just trying to screaming. And yeah, right. You know, yeah. You're surrounded by trumpet players nonstop.
So like, what's like a, if someone was like wondering like, okay, so people always tell me I should practice long tones or this or that, like what would be like one or two exercises that you do daily that you could recommend?
First of all, like a big thing for me is like, once I realized that I was relying on, I mean, this goes back to the physical nature of what we do, but like about 9 years ago, I started studying out of this book and I realized that like, I'd never really taken time to like, see if I could get a decent sound on the mouthpiece, let alone buzz with no mouthpiece, what people call free buzzing.
Yeah.
And man, I realized I couldn't do it. Basically what that meant is I had relied on manipulating the horn essentially to get a sound that I wanted.
Yeah.
Which was crippling me in a way because that was forcing a lot of bad habits in my playing. So once I sort of took the horn away and sort of focused on what was happening here and like in my lungs or like in my breath and intention and all that stuff is when things started to open up and become more consistent and more efficient for me in playing. So the thing that I like to do every day is just sit at the piano. First of all, I make sure that I'm like, have a tuning reference and that there's like some sort of time reference, like a metronome or something. And then just play like a B flat. Make sure I get a good sound there. And then I buzz an octave down and then on the mouthpiece. And then on the horn, same thing. I'll do that and go up to concert F. I do that every day for sure.
Sounds like
before
a trumpet.
I go into anything. So if I have 5 minutes or I have an hour, I can do that. I know it's lovely to hear, but that's one thing that I do. How about you?
Yeah. Man, I have this, there's this long tone exercise that I do that is like nothing special. It's just like, I start in the middle of my horn and I go to the lowest note and then I turn around and go all the way up into like the highest note in my range. It's just like I usually go up to like into the altissimo, like a D, E flat, E, depending on.
I think I've heard that one before.
Yep. And it's not teeth on reed, but you know, and I do like a half note followed by a whole note, and I go chromatically. But this is like a nice way for me to like see where I'm at physically and where like the horn is at and kind of just connect with the instrument. Because you know, it's interesting. Maybe you find this, but for me, like after about 30 minutes. Some days, other days it might be 5, other days it might be an hour, but I feel this connection to the horn and I try to like, it becomes like this organic thing. Just totally. By, you know, so I start like on like a middle B, B flat, and I put a metronome on like between, I used to do everything at 60, but as I've over the years, I've slowly even slowed it down even and slower, like 40 to 50, just really slow, just really trying to get inside of that sound and just trying to like, play right in the middle of the tone. So like it might be something as exciting as this. All the way down to the bottom of my horn, you know. And doing this like
it's
really
riveting
just trying
stuff.
To say what?
It's riveting stuff.
Riveting, but there's no replacement for this.
Right.
Flip side of that, another one that I do is like on the saxophone, you know, just like the trumpet, the overtone series is an integral part of like creating a sound and controlling and shaping your tone. So I'll do the overtone matching where I'll start on that same B flat. Mm-hmm. That's like my Lester Young shit. But those two are, you know, kind of like daily mantras for me in a way.
Cool. There's like a teacher named Bill Adam. Well, he's deceased now, but a great trumpet pedagogue, and oftentimes he's talked about, like, it's sort of this idea of expanding from your point of greatness. And it sort of sounds like that's kind of what you're doing. You're starting in a place in the horn that's is very comfortable, yeah. And you expand out from that to sort of feel, to expand the comfortability out to the extremes of your register, right?
Yeah, it's all about the extremes. Because if you can control the extremes, then all that other stuff is great, you know? So, like, on the saxophone, a lot of times if I'm working with, like, a younger, newer player or something like that, I remember this too, like, I used to avoid those regions practicing or playing, and now yeah. It's like I just stay in them, so, like, you know, or
yeah. You
know, just really being able to control and color my tone,
right,
so I could sound like, you know, like a brighter kind of sound, or a darker, more foo-foo subtone. And a lot of these, though, the important thing is, like, using reference points of, like, players and checking sure. out different players that have informed me how to, you know, kind of experiment with my coloring of my tone and things like that.
Right.
What about you? Well, similar kind of vibe?
Yeah, I mean, totally. I think, yeah, it's like, it's obviously harder to control the horn in the extremes. And it's like you said, it's like being able to achieve different colors in the extremes of the register takes a lot of control. So you have yeah. to work on those things, and it's like the slow, deliberate practicing and stuff.
Yeah.
And I think another thing you mentioned too is, like, having a model for what you want to sound like is another important thing too.
Yeah.
And another integral part of practicing is listening. So, and I know you're always inspiring me by, like, the stuff you're listening to, because you're always checking out cool music. So, I think that's an important thing too. Is there anything you're checking out right now that you're digging on? I know this is taking it a little off topic,
you know,
but I'm curious. That's a
funny one. It varies. You know, I feel like, you know, as I've go through periods of heavy, intense listening, and then I go through periods of, like, where I step back, and I think it's once I started writing music a lot more,
mm-hmm.
and making that became, like, kind of like a, you know, normal daily kind of part of my thing. Sometimes if I'm, like, in a heavy writing mode, I listen to less music,
right?
Because I'll find myself like straight up copying things, and I'm like, yeah. Oh, this is so killing. And then I go back and listen to that album, and I'm like, oh shit, that's not mine. Or I have to find a way to flip it and make it mine, you know. So it just depends, you know.
I feel you. Yeah, it definitely seems to oscillate. I think that's healthy too, to, like, kind of go back and forth with that. And also, I mean, in terms of practicing too, like, you know, having, like, a routine and a regimented practice versus sort of, like, sitting down and being creative and just allowing, I mean, it sort of ties in with the writing too, I believe, but, like, just sitting down and, like, playing a tune for an hour and a half, getting inside a song.
That's fun.
I love it. Yeah. But it's a different kind of discipline, and it's a different kind of practice, right?
Definitely.
Would you say, or is it similar?
Yeah. Yes and no. It just depends. I think it depends on where your headspace is and what your goals are for what you're trying to get out of. Are you, you know, so I think one thing I wanted before we, like, depart from practice talk and all that stuff, I think it's important. There's a lot of people out there that play multi-instrument. They're multi-instrumentalists, like Justin here, incredible trumpet player. And then he sits down at a keyboard or piano and you're like, wait.
You're too kind.
You know? But, you know, I too also play various other instruments, and I used to always try and I compartmentalize things. So I put, like, the saxophone on this stand, and then I put the flute on this stand. But over the years, like, I've also learned too to try and make everything a little more organic.
Mm-hmm.
And like, you know, so, like, some of these things that I do on the saxophone, they don't necessarily translate to an instrument like the flute or the bass clarinet or whatever. But I've slowly, it's become more and more, like, kind of like this, like, the same. The way I practice flute, I don't think about it differently than the saxophone now. It's just me moving air, you know what I mean?
Totally. Yeah.
But do you ever think about stuff like that, you know, transferring between the different instruments and things like that?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I've always said that, like, things sort of bleed in from one instrument to the other. Like, you know, like certain things, like more angular things that are possible on the keyboard might not seem as obvious on the trumpet, just because.
Unless you're Woody Shaw.
Yeah, right. Exactly. But yeah, it sort of forces you. I mean, piano is obviously more visual too, so you can sort of see what's happening and then sort of emulate that. And but I totally agree, man. Like if I sit and do like some technical exercises, a lot of times I'll play them on both instruments, and I find that super helpful.
Yeah,
little chromatic exercises and things and scales and stuff like that. And actually, I've been working. I do it every now and then. I probably should do it more. But there's a nice book that was written, God knows when. But it's pretty famous in the trumpet world. It's written by a composer named Conconi. And I think they were originally written for voice.
Uh-huh. I've heard
basically
that.
They're like these beautiful, like lyrical etudes, basically.
Yeah.
But they have the melody in the treble staff, and then the bass clef is like a piano kind of. So the idea is like you sit and you sing solfege and you accompany yourself playing them.
Mm-hmm.
What I'll try to do the old Nick Payton special, like kind of do that. I mean, yeah, I mean, they're definitely like classical. They're very operatic, like aria kind of things, but super beautiful writing. And it's a good little exercise to sort of think in two different keys and read and sort of try to get a good sound. I need one of those cool things though, like he has. So I mean, this is a little taxing. I hate to sound like a baby, but.
The Schulman system, that little.
Yeah, I do. Yeah. I thought about that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe Yamaha's selling something, man. Maybe I need to hit him up, set us up for the one-handed trumpet player.
Yeah. I need two hands, so I can't play the keys, but that would be.
You're out of luck.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were talking about improvisation, and thought maybe we would do like an example of something, maybe to demonstrate how we might practice that or how we might apply it in Snarky Puppy world.
Yeah. So what were we talking about? We were talking about Quartermaster, right?
Yeah. It's a song off the record Ground Up, recorded in the Stone Age. 2011, maybe.
Yeah. It's a great tune to talk about improvisation as well, because it was inspired by the, you know, music of New Orleans.
Right.
And,
totally. And when Chris and I were talking about putting this together, there's a video that's pretty well known that's circling around the internet of Wynton Marsalis and Marciac in France at their jazz festival there. And I think it's him and his saxophone player, Wes Anderson, playing. They're just playing Happy Birthday. And I think it's Wes, and he's just playing the melody, and Wynton is sort of improvising around the melody while he just plays the melody. So we thought the Quartermaster would be another good way to sort of demonstrate this kind of concept. So maybe we'll give it a shot here. Thank you.
So, C7, what are you thinking? Or in this case, D7, what are you thinking? Wasn't that like one time somebody asked that?
Yeah, well, I think the joke was like somebody, one of our friends was on a flight and they saw Pat Metheny on the same flight.
Oh, yeah.
And they said as a joke, they're like, so Pat, C minor 7, what are you thinking? You imagine? We're just like, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, with something like this, you know, you have the two sections. You have like the beginning session that's basically like sort of like a, I mean, it's a New Orleans style tune, but we play it a bunch of different ways. And a lot of times we approach it like a James Brown thing. And like a lot of James Brown's music harmonically is not super complicated, but it's all about the groove and what's happening in that and the feel. So you basically have something that's over the one chord. In D.
Yeah.
And then you hit this second section, which has more chord changes. And then you feel like you're probably trying to outline the changes a little bit more, right?
Yeah. And you know, with this tune, because we do it in different like styles, because you know, we'll play it over, you know, the span of like a month long tour. One night it might be like a down tempo kind of like sassy, kind of almost swinging kind of vibe. And then other nights it's like the, you know, 1978 James Brown, let's go. And it varies from, you know, from night to night. So and we wouldn't be able to do that if we didn't have the perspective of like these different kinds of like, you know, reference points. So like knowing how like a horn player in James Brown band might play, like how Maceo or Pee Wee Ellis or Fred Wesley and these guys, you know, I think of like in a tune like Quartermaster, I think more like I'm part of the rhythm section, like I'm a drummer.
And I'm right.
It's not about the notes and it's not about harmonically what I can do and how I can push this and that. It's more about like I'm a drummer and I have to play very rhythmically and like try and get in there with the rest of the ensemble, you know.
Totally. Yeah, and you mentioned Lester Young earlier, and it makes me think of like, okay, the way Lester Young plays, I mean, he's like, I know I'm generalizing very broadly here, so you can sort of rein it in to make it more specific, but I feel like Lester Young has a way of like, even on something that's has a lot of chord changes, finding the notes like within, it's not just about like outlining the harmony in a solo. It's like figuring out how to play something melodic over a set of chord changes, like it could stand alone. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, totally. I mean, and he's, you know, a great example of, he just finds like the most beautiful melodic way to navigate a tune, you know?
Yeah.
You know, whether it's fast, slow, whatever. And it's also, I think it's important too, to remember like, you know, sometimes I think back to like as a young improviser, when it would be like, I'd play the melody and then I would play the solo and they would have nothing to do with each other.
Right.
But like, my favorite musicians and, you know, that are alive, you know, that I go see or get to play with, like, it's all like organic. And if you're blowing on a tune, but you have no idea, like it's not connected to the melody or the, the underlying rhythm of the tune, it's like just nonsense, like me just talking nonsense.
Sure, and you're going to end up playing the same thing on every song, like.
Yeah, totally. So, you know, it over time too, I think it becomes more of like a, instead of improvising or on a set of chord changes, I'm playing the tune, you know what I mean?
Right.
So I think that's to remember, you know, to like younger, like I just like to, you know, impress that upon like, you know, younger musicians, you know.
Totally. Yeah. A lot of people ask about how do you get inspired? Like I'm in a rut, you know? And I think the answer is always the song.
Yeah.
Always refer to the song. It's like not your bag.
Yeah.
Because that's limited.
But, these tunes that like are simple, like, you know, one chord kind of vamps for a little while are fun ones too to experiment and like also find some different ways to like bring different, like, you know, the band might be playing like really hard and whatever. And sometimes it might be nice to just like come in and be super melodic and kind of play pretty. And it creates this nice juxtaposition, you know, or the vice versa. They could be playing quiet and you can just come in. It just, I just like that kind of variety and that kind of, creativity, you know.
Totally. It's music. There's not a right answer, and it's really just about conviction, I think.
Totally.
Totally. Speaking of conviction, when we get to, we're both soloing on that tune, and then we get to the C section, and we play together. And, you know, depending on how we're playing it, whatever night, it's important that we are sort of lined up and playing together, right?
Yeah.
And, and this is another thing I feel like it's probably important to talk about is like the blending and horn section playing. And Quartermaster is one example of that. And then also like anything like sort of horn focused. I mean, we have to sort of satisfy a lot of different roles, whether like in Snarky Puppy, there's a lot of different riders in the band and everybody kind of brings different kind of vibes to everybody's coming from different places and backgrounds in their music. So you have to approach it as a horn section in different ways. So, Quartermaster is one example. And then a similar example is a tune I wrote, Bad Kids to the Back. It's like very aggressive and, it needs to be very tight. You know, it's like funky tune. So.
A video clip of us playing Bad Kids to the Back from a little side stage camera that I bring on the road sometimes. So check this out.
Cool. So, yeah, that was it. That was a bit from Bad Kids from a tour somewhere in the world. Do you remember where that was?
Somewhere in Europe.
Somewhere in Europe. Okay, that works. And that was.
I'd have to check my notes, but it's not there. Maybe we could.
So we played that a bunch, but that one's pretty consistent, like how we play it. So I feel like, you know, it's pretty on top and it's pretty aggressive. So. I mean, Chris, how do you approach playing it differently versus like a tune like Quartermaster or another tune that we play?
Yeah, you know, it's such like a tight, like biting kind of melody and like super rhythmic. And I just try to get inside of the trumpet sounds, you know. And so like what that might mean is like I might play with a little more edge in my tone. So like I normally it varies, you know, depending on the mood or what I'm feeling. But like. Like that might be too dark, you know, so
right,
you know, I might, you know, kind of just end up pushing a little more air, kind of like manipulating my embouchure in a way that just allows me to just, you know, cut with the trumpets and really just fit in that sonic world that you guys can get, you know, with that instrument.
Right. That's interesting. You just played it super light that for a second. I was like, If I might have to try that sometime. I don't know if it'll hurt.
Yeah. I can't
again,
wait for that day.
It's another example of like fitting in with the rhythm section, because the rhythm section is playing super aggressively. And it's like you were saying earlier, like sometimes like in soloing, you want to contrast with what's going on in the rhythm section, but other times you want to fit in. But typically, I think like when you're playing as a horn section, I mean, there's no rules across the board, but like in this case, it's a pretty clear example of like, okay, our intensity needs to match the intensity of the rhythm section.
Yeah. And, you know, some great examples like to just build some kind of reference is like, you know, I think of like the Duke Ellington band is such like an incredible example, because they play really intense and then they can play the most lush, beautiful vibe too, and really can like alter their sound. But then flip that.
Yeah, talk like, about colors.
Oh man, you know, and the different players have such a distinct like tone individually, and they bring that, and it just adds to the richness of of it all. And then on the flip side of like some of like our favorite, like, you know, like that's like a faster kind of like, you know, high energy kind of like funk rhythm based kind of tune. I don't know what to call it, but what would you call it?
I don't know.
Yeah, who knows? Who cares? Just as long as it sounds fun. But like, you know, some like tight, like some horn sections that play really tight, like, you know, anywhere from like, what are some of your favorite examples of those kind of like horn sections?
I mean, for me, for something like that, like the reference would be like Earth, Wind, and Fire, for sure. One of the best horn sections. And one I always forget to mention that's actually my favorite, but I wouldn't say necessarily is a reference to Bad Kids, but is Sly and Family Stone, is one of my favorite horn sections of all time. The part writing and the playing is so unique. I love it.
Yeah.
But it's such a vibe, for real. Totally. Like,
yeah.
But I also think like in terms of Bad Kids thing, I mean, maybe like some of the Brecker Brothers stuff that you hear, and not the band, but like the stuff they play on pop records, like the stuff on Cameo and
then with Parliament, definitely.
Yeah, totally. That Chaka Khan record, What You Gonna Do For Me?
Yeah.
Killer horn stuff. Man, so good.
Yeah, just like super swinging, super tight, grooving.
Yeah, and even like some of the Roy Hargrove stuff with D'Angelo, kind of like just that sort of like swing, like swagger swing kind of thing. I mean, yeah. Bad Kids doesn't sound like D'Angelo, but that's definitely sort of an influence of that, like that tune, was it Sugar Daddy?
Mm-hmm.
Like the way,
yeah, and Roy's
the
just
way,
like right
the way
in the
that
middle.
Beat feels, yeah, is sort of what I had in mind for Bad Kids, that sort of swung funk kind of thing. It's like super aggressive and like really like, ugh.
Yeah. And Roy brings so much like patience to that kind of vibe too, though.
That's true. Yeah.
You know, super unique. Another good example for saxophone is Joshua Redman, like the it's like the Ya Ya record, and then what's the other one? The
Momentum?
I forget off the top of my head right now, but he like where he had like the when there was like Brian Blade, Sam Yahel playing organ and
keyboard. Yeah.
But there, yeah, it'll come to me as soon as we finish, we hit stop. But he's really great because he can
Oh, Elastic.
Elastic, yeah, that's the one. Like Elastic's another, I always use that as a reference for that kind of swing and funk for saxophone sound, like in like a modern player, you know.
Totally. So, yeah, he's great.
Modern as in like the last 20 years.
Right. So. I know. Oh man, it's so true. But it's something that could contrast with that. I mean, like done Quartermaster, we've done Bad Kids. Maybe we could talk about your tune, Beatbox.
Well, first, before we talk anything, check out this video of us playing beatbox live somewhere in the world. while back, I wrote beatbox and brought it to the band. And it was like, I just was looking for something that was, when I wrote it, I was like, this seems like it might work with a band, but it's completely different than what a lot of the tunes we normally play, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, it's a nice, like, kind of Sage of the Room tune. And over the years, like, League oftentimes will put it at the beginning of a set. And it's a nice way to just, like, you know, that anxious energy to come out and start a show as, like, a performer, you know? Or as, like, an audience where you're like, oh, I'm excited. Or you're like, what they got? And it just kind of sages the room. And it's cool. I never would have thought that it would work like that. But
it's true. But you know what? It's also what I love about the tune, too. I mean, I love a lot of things about the tune, but I love that in the middle, you do have a spike in energy. And if you know the song and you can tell in certain nights, like, people are waiting for that moment of, like, because it's just, it's so patient. Yeah. But I love that. I could never write a song like that where it just sits and it's like, and then, man, it hits. And it's like, every time we play it, man, I'm like, yeah, here we go. I'm ready, bro. I'm out in the audience when I'm playing this song. Totally. I love this song. We play that a different way. Like we're thinking in terms of blending and thinking more of the soft sound and sort of getting inside the sound rather than like sort of pushing the sound, what you were talking about with Bad Kids. But also you're doing stuff with effects too. I mean, would you say that sort of influences your decision on how you would play, or can you talk about that a bit?
That tune is like such a gentle, it starts off kind of gentle, you know, and kind of mysterious. And so like, you know, these bigger flutes, like this is a bass flute, a Yamaha bass flute, and it's a fantastic instrument. Love this thing. It's such like a quiet, you know. So it like it immediately tells the rest of the band like, oh, we got to bring it down, maybe, you know.
It should.
Yeah. So and you get that breathiness, and then the melody happens, and then the melody happens again with the full horn section, and it. A lot of times I'll have two microphones, and Moz does the same thing where we'll push them together. We have an effects mic and a clean mic. And for that tune, like beatbox or Gemini, like some kind of like plate reverb, some kind of delay with the mod on, always mod on. Get that ride that wave, you know.
Ride the wave, totally.
Just tuning,
LFO, like, baby.
You know, like, and we LFO all the time without that other frequency, you know, with our vibrato and things, you know. So
right.
Just like finding a way to like. To create a vibe and an atmosphere with your like effects. And so as a horn player, that was something that I had to learn, because I didn't know, because I played a little bit of guitar back in the day, but I had to, like, you know, I have this like this shelf, and it's kind of like a, some of it, part of it is like pedal graveyard, the ones that didn't make the cut, but you save for production, that for other instruments it works great, you know, for recording at home, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But like certain kind of effects work really great on trumpet that don't work on saxophone. Certain things work on saxophone that don't work on the flute, you know.
What? Can you give an example of that?
Well, like saxophone with like an auto wah, great. Flute with an auto wah, not great.
Okay.
Saxophone with a fuzz pedal, you got to have a gate. Same for a trumpet, but like, you know, trumpet, just because the sound is so direct, because it's coming from one place, you like things like distortion and fuzz work so great. But like, you know, like I just, you know, use a lot of like delays and reverb, different types of reverb depending on the tune, and I adjust the size and the repeats.
Well, I think like, something you said was important, that like, yeah, you can use this, but only if you have this. I think is an important thing, kind of what you were saying before, is like coming from this as a guitarist, or even a keyboardist or a bassist, these pedals were designed for them. They're designed to work with instruments that you plug in, and not necessarily designed with a horn player in mind, not to say that they can't be utilized, but you have to sort of do things that, like, what are some things that maybe people might not be aware of? Like, I can just plug this pedal in and play a show. Like, obviously that's not what you're doing. There's more involved, right?
Yeah, just to break it down in a real simple way, like, so, like a guitar is like it's called line level, and it's a quieter signal than like a stereo blend from like a Prophet 6 or something like that. So you have to boost your signal into the pedals.
Right.
You have to increase the, and so I have this box it's called a synapse, and it's got a gain. So I can gain up my sound from the microphone into that box, and then I gain it up without distorting it. It just makes it hotter, and then it runs it through the pedals, and they respond so much better. And but before I got one of those, the pedals didn't really work that great, and it was just kind of like frustrating, because it sometimes would sound good depending on the venue or the sound engineer or whatever. But then I got that box, it works all the time.
Right. Because basically, like, if you're at the mercy of the sound engineer, they're having to gain up your microphone. If you don't have a preamp or something to sort of boost your signal, they're gaining up your microphone, so it's causing a lot of feedback more often than not, right?
Yeah.
It's a common problem.
Yeah, so you got to make sure you take care of that. And then after that, it's just kind of like, there was a point in time where Moz and I were just like, you know, borrowing pedals from people and trying different things. And then you find some things that work for you. And I also, too, like, don't like to keep the same pedal board for every tour. Every, like, you know, 3 to 6 months, I switch it up and pull one off, pull one on, because it just kind of gets kind of monotonous. Another thing that works really great on horns, if you want to, like, if you're soloing, and I learned this from, like, some of these, like, great 80s what's that Brecker solo on like early 80s, what record is that? But a lot of times, like, these guys would put a little chorus.
Now you got me curious. Is it a pop thing?
It's not Wham. It's
it's not Cameo?
Cameo, the Cameo, yes. And you hear, like, that era, they would always put a little bit of, like, chorus on trumpet or saxophone.
Yeah.
And that detuning it a little bit, like, just makes it sit on top of all the other things sonically happening, because, you know, tenor saxophone is a tricky one because it sits in the same register as, like, the keyboard, that middle register. And so I have to, like, bring my sound. And if I want to sit on top of the band or get back into the mix and back into the weeds, you know, so there's different little tricks that you can do. And chorus, I just a little bit of chorus makes solos just, like, pop or, like, slap.
Yeah. I mean, as a keyboardist, you'd sort of do the same thing. And so it fattens up the sound and makes the sound bigger.
Yeah. You have the purists, though, that, like, well, you spend all this time working on your tone and doing all this stuff, and then you run it through all these things and just completely distort it. And I say, why not? Because because it's a personal choice. And number two, you can find creative ways to blend both sounds. And that's why, like, Moz and I typically always have two microphones, because if I just always played clean, like, I don't know. And kind of, I mean,
to be fair, though, you're coming from a place of it's not that you're relying on the pedals as a crutch to, I mean, yeah, you're achieving sounds with the pedals, but it's not, you're not, like, relying on the pedals to add music to what you're playing. It's like we were talking about before, like, your fundamentals are there, like, all the things are there. If you have to play the gig dry with no pedals, it's going to sound great. It's just, it's an addition. It's a choice, like you said.
Yeah.
It's not a crutch.
Totally. And if anything, it's just like when you go into a recording studio, they don't just plug a mic straight into the board. They're going to put it through a preamp, and they're going to warm things up. And depending on the kind of microphone you're playing, there's some things that are going to color your tone.
Totally.
And I'm just trying to bring that kind of control, and I'm trying to curate that sound on stage in a live setting.
Yeah.
And the pedals kind of give me some access and freedom to do that, you know, which is, you know, I just feel like it just adds more to my, you know, you went from the 32 pack of crayons to the 64 pack.
Totally.
Colors, you know.
Well, yeah. I mean, come on. It's not fair. Everybody else got pedals and shit on stage, like keyboards and guitars and everything else. So it's like, yeah, horns got to get some love too. Why not? But speaking of curating your sound, and speaking of not touring and doing these things, maybe we can talk a little bit about what we're doing at home to sort of achieve similar results of these things that we've gotten used to doing live while we're at home more, doing projects at home. Maybe people are recording at home for other people or themselves. Maybe we could talk about certain ways that, like, when you open up your computer, it's like, okay, now what? I want to record myself. Now what?
Definitely. Yeah.
What do you think? I mean, I use Logic. I think you use Logic too.
Yeah, I use Logic and Pro Tools, just depending on the project and who I'm working with. Because some people are either way. I feel the most comfortable in Logic just because I spent the most time with it. A lot of people really love Ableton for different types of music and things like that. So there's a lot of different options. It's just like finding one that you have access to And it doesn't take much. If you have a microphone, you get like a, you can even get like a, not a great microphone, but you can still record and get nice results. You know, it doesn't, you know, that you can get caught up in like, I need the nicest thing or not. But honestly, it's just kind of fun to just start with what you have and go from there.
Totally. Yeah. I mean, definitely it's a place to start. I mean, yeah, in terms of using Logic, I mean, there's so many things that come with the software now that allow you to, I mean, from effects, like, I just bought Gisella a guitar for Christmas.
Nice.
So, like, I was just like, yo, I mean, even in GarageBand, you can open up, like, an amplifier simulator and, like, say you want to mess with effects. Like, it's like, say you're considering, like, yeah, I want to get into pedals, but I don't know what to do. If you have a microphone at home, you set up and play in a GarageBand, figure out the kind of sounds you like, and then you go get the pedals that you like, something you can take with you out on the road.
Definitely. And I think now too, because of the internet, there's like so many great videos and like articles written about home production that you can, if you have a question, like if I'm ever like working, like, so right now I'm working on a film score, and I also have like on the back burner a record I made in October that I've worked with a little bit, you know, and anytime I have a question, I just like, you know, kind of Google like, okay, like, and learning a lot, like the first thing I think is super, like, that's, I've learned a lot is like, when to mess with EQ and when to not mess with EQ. And there's all kinds of different opinions, but that's like a good place to start before you start putting other things on your sound. It's just learning how to like figure out, okay, the room you're recording in, the kind of mic you have, and the kind of sound you're going for or getting, and then kind of working with those like simple things, you know, and changing those factors, space and microphone and distance and things like that.
Absolutely. Yeah, there's a lot of basic things, right? And then just once you have that. But yeah, I mean, I think if you talk to most engineers, they're going to say exactly what you said. They're going to say, I mean, I've talked to Nick Hards, who's our friend and recording engineer for Snarky Puppy, and also works with Chris and myself, and Bill Lawrence, and everybody. But he would say the room for sure is important. Yeah. And the microphone.
Man, I've stolen so much stuff from that guy. I remember when I was like mixing my Boomtown record that I put out 2 years ago. I have this notepad, and I was just like annoying him to the point where he's like, dude, maybe I can just work a little bit. Cause I'd be like, what are you doing? What is that? And just like writing this stuff down. But whenever you're hanging out with your sound engineer friends or mixing engineer friends or mastering engineer friends, like I just ask them questions because they love talking about it too. Because oftentimes they're sitting in a room by themselves alone or sitting behind a board alone. And so they want to share. And I've learned so much, you know, or if I like have been at a show and heard something I really liked, I'm like, how was that happening?
Yeah.
You know?
Or exactly. Like if I'm on a gig and, you know, I like the way the piano's sounding. Like if I'm playing piano on a gig, mm-hmm. I'll look at the microphones. I'll see what microphones they're using and where they put the microphones, like the placement of the microphones. All that stuff's important. And you sort of gain a base of knowledge through experience. And the advantage, of course, is you can look a lot of stuff up online. But if you have the opportunities to put yourself in situations, even like work, like being in a studio or working in a studio, and you know, there's one way about it. It's like what you said, Chris, is like you ask a lot of questions. But sometimes you just be the fly on the wall and observe. If you're not really in a position to say anything or assert yourself, then this is like I'm gonna just chill and see what I see.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think too, especially as a horn player, like if you do a session at someone's house or at a studio and there's a microphone and you go back and listen, like, I love that sound. Like find the microphone that worked that you dig. So years ago I did a session, I was like, what is that microphone? And at the time I like couldn't afford that microphone. But later on I saved up and got this Royer, and it's like a beautiful ribbon mic, and it makes tenor sound beautiful, and flute and other instruments too. You can put it in front of a guitar amp, but that's just one example, you know?
Oftentimes, like you said, sorry to cut you off, but I was going to say, if you do go into a studio and you're playing on an expensive microphone, chances are if the engineer is like, well, this is like a $10,000 microphone, you can be like, okay, I really like the sound. Is there anything you could recommend that's like maybe a little cheaper, but similar? A lot of times they'll be able to help you out, and
totally,
it's just good to ask.
And it's also important to know what you don't want to play on, because there are certain microphones that I just do not like the way they sound with my tone.
Yeah.
And that's okay, you know? And like there's certain, you know, if I'm playing, like if I go on the road with my band and I'm not playing big, I'm playing like a bar gig, you know, at a small place. And it's like a certain type of mic. I'm like, okay. So you know what I do? I carry my own mic.
Right.
That's an easy way to fix that solution, because your tone and your sound is the first thing people will notice when you play a note, whether
100%.
You're playing drums, whether you're singing, whether you're playing a horn. And I feel like you have to preserve that. And like, I just strive, like my sound is my card, you know, like here's my card. That's my sound. And so
you preach it right now. I love it. It's true. It's so true. I just say that because it's true. It's like your sound, if there's nothing else you get out of what was said this whole time, that's it.
Yeah.
The sound is it. And whatever you can do to get your sound happen. Like Chris and I play Yamaha horns. Obviously we're doing this thing for Yamaha, but we had an opportunity to go in and try a lot of horns, and we listened to each other play, and also Maz and Jay, and we all listened to each other play on a variety of different horns, and we go, boom. And oftentimes whenever someone would play the horn, and Chris, you remember this, like you play the horn, both the person, the individual playing and the people listening both agreed, this is the horn.
Totally.
And yeah. You know, and it helps you best represent yourself and what sound you want to achieve.
Yeah,
and the same thing goes with microphones and et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah. And it's nice to have another set of ears. So it's not just, you know, because the self-doubt can come in and all that stuff like that. You're like, is this right? But having
plus you're on the other side of the horn. It's like you can't. Yeah. I mean, especially on trumpet, like it's definitely good to have the extra set of ears.
And then how many years we've been playing together since like 2000. And we've maybe played together for the first time in like 2005, maybe.
Probably. Yeah.
Two, 3 years. And I have a pretty intimate understanding of the different sound vibe that each of you guys have in Snarky. And I would imagine you do too. And so like, it's good to have some ears that, you know, that you're comfortable with and you all know each other, like to take with you if you're ever trying out horns or like, you know.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely good to have like the expert opinion.
Yeah. And on that note, I think this might be a good time to like wrap things up. And I guess we're going to take some questions and have a little chat with all of y'all here in a few. So, Justin, this was fun.
Definitely fun. We made it.
No, we really appreciate you, Yamaha, asking us to take a little time and share some noise.
Yeah.
Thanks, Chris. Thanks, Justin. That was great.
Thank you, Bray.
Yeah, thanks, Bray.
No problems. I did next to nothing, so it's
all good. That's not true.
We've got a couple of questions. Thanks, everyone, for attending again. It's really great to see so many people and so many familiar faces in the chat, too. So thanks very much. We're going to start with a couple of... sort of basic questions. Aletta Bormant, sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrong. I'm still trying to understand overtones on the saxophone. How do they work? And is it written down? If it's in a score, or also maybe some books that you would recommend on overtones for the saxophone?
Yeah, okay. Totally. I got this.
No, I'm just playing. No.
Go ahead. I want to hear it, Justin. Teach us. No, enlighten us.
Go.
Yeah. There's a handful of like books and people have, you know, written and talked about it, but there's one in particular. There's like a guy named Sigurd Rascher, who was like a famous teacher and player back in the day. He's no longer living, but he wrote a book called Top Tones for the Saxophone, which I think is a really great place to start. He describes these overtone series in like a really clear, understandable way. And there's lots of exercises. And I have used that book, you know, from the time I was like 14 years old or something like that. And it's a good place to start, you know. And then also just find some saxophone players close to you and that can do that and chat them. Cause that's how I learned. I heard a friend of mine playing like bugle calls on a saxophone with one fingering. And I was like, how are you doing this? You know? It's a fun starting to learn how to do that. But once you start learning how to control the overtones, you are able to manipulate your sound in different ways and just control the horn in a greater way. And it's a fun rabbit hole to dive down. So best of luck with you. You got to make a lot of really bad noises first, though, before you can make the good noises playing overtones, and maybe do it in a room alone. Now you go, Justin. What about you?
In a zip code alone, please.
Yeah, probably.
A follow-up question that we had to that was, what point do you go from a student instrument to a pro horn, and will a student horn cut it? That's from the same person.
Well, bottom line is you need to feel comfortable with whatever you're playing on. Certainly, there's a guy that's done a few videos online. His name's Charlie Porter. He's a trumpet player, great trumpet player. And he plays Monette horns. I think he lives in Portland, and I think that's where Monette is based, somewhere in the Pacific Northwest in the United States. He plays Monette horns, but he also does this thing. He's like, oh, what's the difference between a $200 trumpet and a $20,000 trumpet? And, you know, he plays on different mouthpieces and different horns and sort of does different combinations. And you can hear the difference between the two. And at the end of our sort of tape discussion that you just heard, we're sort of talking about that. You want the horn that you can best represent yourself on and what you're trying to achieve. I played a student horn for about a year and a half, and then I had a teacher recommend that I upgrade to something a little better. We also talked in the discussion about, you know, controlling, being able to have more control in the extreme parts of your register. Those things are going to be easier to do on a horn that's nicer. You're going to be able to have more control. So depending on the kind of music that you're playing, the kind of things that you're having to do, a little more refinement in the horn might be more necessary. Chris, what do you think?
Yeah, horns are just half of it, because so much of like getting a good sound on a horn is the physical aspect of just hearing it and producing it, in my opinion. And sometimes you can, like, you know, I remember like the being a young player and like a friend of mine that, you know, might got a new sparkly horn, but like, does it sound good? Maybe not. So it just depends on the time you spend with that horn first and foremost, and like shedding and practicing and all that, and like learning the instrument. So sometimes like the horn, it's just a filter for the, you know, for your expression of your own individual sound. That being said, there are a lot of great horns of different, you know, price brackets and things like that. But like a professional horn, you know, I think I got one like my senior year of high school. I got a tenor that wasn't considered a beginner horn. And at that point I was serious about music and I was playing a lot, and it definitely helped, you know, bridge me to, you know, getting a better sound and everything like that. But there's a lot of options, you know, but definitely just go try a bunch of horns and see what feels good to you. Because what might feel good to me might not feel good to Justin. It might not feel good to the next person. So, you know, it's a pretty personal thing. But it's just nice to be aware. It's like you don't go buy a car. You don't drive that one and, okay, I'm taking that one. You might try a few. Who knows? So.
Right.
Yeah.
You want something that's in good condition. You know, like if it doesn't feel right, like if the valves are messed up or like the slides don't feel good, like if the horn doesn't feel good, it's the same on any instrument. It's definitely the same on piano. If you sit down at a piano and you play it, it doesn't feel right. It's like you're not going to enjoy. You want an instrument that you want to play. That's the bottom line.
Totally.
An instrument that you want to practice. Okay? So I think that's maybe the short answer there.
Yeah.
I like it. So we also have a question from Matt Taylor. How important are pedal tones on trumpet, Justin?
Oh, wow.
Or Chris.
Certainly, tones are written. I definitely go through phases where I practice pedal tones. And certainly, like anybody that studied out of the book of James Stamp would talk about the importance of pedal tones. There's certainly a feeling that, like, to build a solid foundation, literally and figuratively, on the horn, your low range has to be solid. You have to be solid in the bottom to sort of expand up. And it's kind of what I touched on a little bit in the beginning of the discussion with the teacher, Bill Adam. What's important, I think, this is where I'm at right now. You know, our philosophies change as we practice and we evolve as artists and musicians. Where I'm at now, I feel like it's important to sort of find your point where you feel most comfortable and sort of expand that feeling of comfortability out into extremes, extreme registers, both high and low. So a lot of times when I'm doing warm-up exercises, I'll start somewhere that feels very comfortable and I'll expand that down and up because I want to get the feeling of like a G in the staff. I want to have that feeling above the staff and I want to have that feeling in the pedal register. Certainly the pedal tones, I'm not an expert on it, but I would say they're important in that way. But if you're going to work on them, I would say work from the middle down.
Great answer. I love that answer.
Totally.
Okay, a couple of other ones. We'll talk more about your work with Snarky. From Glenn Clark, Glenn in Sydney. Hi, Glenn. Do you make a conscious decision to create that Snarky puppy horns section sound? And there's a couple of follow-up questions that lead into this, but let's start with that.
Go ahead, Chris.
What was the question again, Bray? Like, can you say that again?
So the way Glenn's worded it is, do you make a conscious decision to create that Snarky puppy, that great Snarky puppy horn section sound? And I think maybe the idea is it a democratic process? Is there a designated leader and that sort of thing? What's the process in creating that sound for you guys?
You know, I think the sound is created by the simple way to answer that is like who's on the gig. And like the fun thing about the music of Snarky is that some of the tunes, there might be a lot of unison passages, but then there's other tunes where it'll break into harmony. Sometimes that might be 2-part harmony, 3-part harmony or more, depending on how many horns we have. So we all kind of have to know all of the different parts because there might be a gig where there's only 2 horns and then 2 nights later, there's going to be 4 horns. And what we played 2 nights ago doesn't work in that setting. So we want to expand upon it. So it just depends on who's on the stage and how many of us there are. And we kind of figure out, like, before the gig, we'll have a little brief chat, like, okay, well, on such and such, we might get like the set list and like, okay, I'll take that part, blah, blah, blah. And then boom, you know, because we've been playing this music for so long. But yeah, you know, if we've had a couple weeks, months, or in this case, year off the road, that first few gigs will be fun to go back and be like, okay, what were those parts? You know, just figuring out the little intricacies of all the details and things like that. But that kind of determines, like, you know, I feel like the sound of the horn section, so to say. What do you think, Justin?
Certainly. That's super important. I think on a micro level, that's important. I think on maybe a more macro level, because we've spent so much time playing together, even if it's new music, people bring in new songs. I think it's sort of a twofold thing. It's like, on one hand, Snarky is very democratic in that, like, if someone has an idea that seems to fit the general sort of the overall feeling of the tune better, and it sort of improves upon what's there, then usually everybody's willing to go with that idea, whatever idea is presented. But first and foremost is that we try to satisfy the vision of the composer. So as that applies to a horn section, that might, to be specific, that might be, okay, are we going to play this unison? Are we going to play this in octaves? Are we going to harmonize it? How are we going to approach this as a horn section? And so to say, all right, how do we get a Snarky puppy sound? I don't think there's like any cookie cutter way to do it. It's like we treat every tune with the equal amount of respect that the composer has put into something and try to achieve a unique identity within that song.
Yeah, and like the beauty of it, I think these things evolve. You know, like we might do something in a very traditional way, maybe on a recording, just because it makes sense. But then after playing a song on the road over a given amount of time, we get kind of bored with that, like, you know, human nature. So we might flip things and put the melody or the instrumentation or the voicing in not such a, you know, traditional way or something like that. So just to keep things interesting to us and maybe to the listener. So
that's true. That happens. But, you know, I think it's more, there's more to it than it being like out of boredom. I think things are made deliberately with like musical sort of like, there's definitely aesthetic choices. It's not just for the sake, because I think the pitfall of like saying something like that sometimes in a group that doesn't have as much experience is like, oh, I'm bored, I just want to do something different. But I think a lot of the decisions that are made are coming from very informed places and coming from places of like, there's a lot of experience being had on the road of like playing the shows, and these things sort of evolve organically and naturally, right? Wouldn't you say?
Definitely.
So subsequent to that, there's a couple of other questions that sort of lead into that sort of discussion as well. Do modern synth sounds change or expand the variety of tones and how you approach each tune? Do the modern synth sounds expand that? Or do you think that that juxtaposition that you were talking about earlier, Chris, that's sort of more important to developing the sound as a section? And then there was another question that sort of along the same lines, the sound as a section with FX, how do you approach that?
Well, we got the synth whiz right here, so
well, you know, the funny thing about all that stuff is now what's in vogue. I mean, I don't know, I'm an old man, I can't say what's in vogue, but it does seem like it's very fashionable to play old keyboards. At least in our band it is, and in a lot of people's band. Like, you know, I use a suite of soft synths made by Arturia that are basically recreations of old keyboards. So it's interesting way to put it as modern synth sounds, because basically it's like a sort of reevaluation of older synth sounds. But I mean, what do you think, Chris? Do you think like those sounds inform your choices, like with pedals and stuff like that?
Yeah, and it's interesting too. I feel like because of the nature of synthesizers and how big they can sound, and then you put guitar and percussion and drums on top of all the, and, you know, throw that into the mix, it kind of like informs us on how we have to shape our tone so we can like exist in that sonic environment. And I know like there was a period of time where like at the early days of Snarky where I was playing on a specific kind of setup, a mouthpiece combination, things like that, that I wasn't able to produce enough volume. So I had to like kind of go back to the drawing board, and it kind of changed the way I played the horn and the sound I was going for. And I think a lot of that had to do with the environment. In this case, it might be synthesizers, you know. And I'm with you on that topic, because a lot of these modern sounds that we hear are actually from the 70s and 80s, you know. So that word modern is kind of a funny one to use carefully, I think. But those things definitely have an impact. And also, like, yeah, in regards to effects pedals, you know, there's specific choices that I like to have options depending on what's going on in the tune or what's going on in the moment. And there's certain things I can do that can help my sound like cut on and sit on top, you know. Like the easiest answer is like putting a little chorus on it. You know, you hear like, that's an easy way to just cut through and have your sound like exist in a more present way. And there's other ways to do that. But it's all, and there's certain things that I've tried many a times and they don't work. And I've, you know, those pedals kind of end up in the closet or on the shelf waiting for the day to be used again in the future. But yeah, that's what I think.
Cool. I like it. Leanne K asks, what's your mix of solo and band practice and discussion theory philosophy practice. So like time spent practicing alone, time spent practicing with Snarky, and then like discussion theory philosophy on music. What's the division there?
Woo. That's a big one.
Not heavy.
I feel like you just asked yeah. like 28 questions in one sentence. That was crazy. Chris, you care to start?
Well, first of all, like Snarky, we don't really rehearse. We rehearse when we make records and we rehearse in sound checks. So there's not a whole lot of that going on, you know. At one point in time, we might have rehearsed a lot, but in the early days, but it, because everyone lives in far places, we get together, we tour, and we get together for concerts and records. So that's like the simple way to answer that one. Obviously, everybody, you know, practices individually. Justin, thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, we do the preparation we need to do to get ready for a gig. But I think to answer your question about what how do we prioritize our practice, I think it's the same that I've been taught by teachers in the past, is like you want to establish like a strong fundamental base on your instrument to be able to execute things no matter what it is. So like I want to be able to create a great sound. I want to be able to articulate in all registers. I want to be able to slur in all registers. I want to be able to do all these things. So I'm not like pigeonholing my practicing per se. And then when I need to learn something, it's like I'm able to execute those things. So it, I don't know. I think it's kind of what we were talking about in the beginning of the Q&A, or not the Q&A, but the beginning of the tape session, is that we're making sure your fundamentals are in line so that like when it's time to execute something, you can do it.
Totally.
And definitely.
The other part of that question, just to follow up on that, and I think it might be, I think I might have an understanding, but there's like a discussion part of music, like a philosophy part of music and a theoretical part of music, obviously. Are they just things that you don't build into your practice, or you build into your practice in a different way so that when the opportunity comes up to say, oh, hey, I need to learn this thing, it happens? Or the philosophy side is just through discussion with other musicians?
Hmm. That's interesting. Yeah. I feel like I have this conversation a lot. Go ahead, Chris. I'm sure you have something better to say.
Hardly at all. I just think, you know, when it comes down to like talking about your philosophy of music and all that stuff, like for me, I think the most important thing are finding a way to connect your ears to your brain. And like, I've like always been a pretty analytical person, just because I think I got that from my father, and he's an engineer and things like that. So I was always good at like breaking things down, but I reached a point where like my brain was ahead of my ears. And what I could think and what I could talk about was not what I could necessarily hear and communicate on my horn. So I had to like do some catch up and get them on an equal playing field, and to the point to make it feel more organic. And so it became a thing where like I don't necessarily have to like discuss or think or talk about these things so much. I can just hear it. So like when it comes to just like if someone sits down at a keyboard or a piano or a guitar and plays a specific kind of chord, and knowing, like just by hearing it, knowing that sound and knowing what I can play on top of that, knowing what will fit, what won't fit, you know, things like that. And just trying to like bring those two worlds together, you know, the aural aspect of learning music and then like the analytical side of things, the theory side of things, you know. I think that's really important, you know. And sometimes like, especially in academic settings in music, you know, I spent a decent amount of time in music school and all that. There's a big emphasis put on theory and theory classes and being like analyzing and music analysis. And then when it comes time to like, okay, well, let's do this and see if we can actually do this, it's can be behind a little bit. So I think it's really important as a musician, if you're pursuing this and wanting to do it, to just like make sure that those things are balanced. And it's a fun journey, and it's a, you know, a fun thing to explore, you know? So,
yeah. If I may expound upon what you just said, because I think all that's totally gold. I tell people a lot, like if I'm doing lessons with people, I'm like, I envision that as like a circle. And to what Chris said about learning all the theory, you've made your journey halfway around the circle. Say the beginning of the circle was like why you got into music in the first place. You heard something, you're like, wow, that is so crazy, and I want to be able to do that. Like, I'm in love with whatever that is, that sound, or I want to be able to do that. That's the beginning of the circle. Halfway around the circle for me is learning B flat 7, sharp 9, sharp 5, triad pairs, and all that shit. You know all that. Okay. Kind of what Chris is saying, I feel like, is like the second half of that journey is like sort of forgetting all of that and being able to, like Chris said, is like you hear something, you hear a sound, and it's like the reaction that you have in a musical way is intuitive rather than academic or analytical. And that's kind of where you want to get, is you want to get back full circle to that, like, I'm reacting to something in an innate way rather than an analytical way. And that's how you connect with people and not just like, I'm trying to impress musicians with what I'm playing with my music. I want to connect with people. I want to connect with somebody who doesn't understand anything about music theory, because why should it matter? That's not why music exists, in my opinion. And I think Chris would agree. It's like, You play music to connect with people, and it's not necessarily just musicians.
Preach.
Yeah, I went Sweet. Off. Sorry.
No. I think that's it's now rant hour in Lisbon. So, as far as I know,
it's funny. Like, I want to just talk a little more about that. Like, recently I've like been digging into Thelonious Monk and his music a little more, just because I've had some time and I've always have enjoyed his music. So I've been trying to learn some of his tunes. But, you know, I have this, like years ago, I bought this like Thelonious Monk. There's like a book that's got all of his tunes that he wrote that someone transcribed. Yeah. And they went to great detail to do that. But the funny thing about it is, like, I found that book and I pulled it out because there was a tune. I was like, what is that chord? And I'm listening to different recordings and checking out, like, Live at Bohemia, Live at this, Live at that. And the chords are different on every recording sometimes, mm-hmm. depending on who's in the band, who's playing that given night. And then I go look at this book and it says, but the book says it's A7 sharp 5. But there, right. what Monk, who wrote the tune, is playing is not an A7 sharp 5 right there. So... You know, there was a point I remember in my, like, I'll rant too. It's almost rant hour. It's like 8 p.m. in New York.
Go, baby.
But
go,
I took all my,
go.
I took my, take books and go to the garbage can and drop them in the garbage can. Even if you spent good money on them, get rid of them because they're wrong. They're not right. You know, things like that. Like, it took me years to learn that. And then I was wondering, like, well, why do I go to gigs and I can't remember these tunes? Because I've been looking at a fake book as opposed to, like, learning the tune in an organic kind of natural way that when you first get started may seem like it takes more time, but you develop that muscle, you know?
Yes.
And, yeah, so throw your fake books away.
Yeah. And I would also say that there's different goals too. Like for instance, like, if we're talking about making music and we're talking about being in this environment, yes, absolutely, 100%. Now, if you're the person that is, okay, I have a band, I'm recording a record and I want horns on my record, so I need to book a horn section, you'd better make sure those charts are as accurate as they possibly can be, so that you're not frustrating people. And I know that's a completely different world, but I would say in the world of music, both of these things exist. So since we're talking about horns, there's nothing better than showing up as a horn player to a session where your chart is like, there's no guesswork.
Totally. I did a session a couple days ago where someone sent me, they're like, I don't have charts, but I'll solo all of the different parts. I had to play some flute, clarinet, and tenor. And I was like, well, your MIDI horns are not cutting off with your strings that you recorded and your trumpet. So what are you supposed to go with? So attention to detail is important. you know.
especially now, because like everybody's doing stuff from home, so it's not like you're sitting in the studio and be like, mm-hmm. well, no, actually, can you cut that off on beat four? You spend time to do the session, you do something, and then you send it, and mm-hmm. they're like, well, actually, I meant to write staccato over that quarter note on beat one. Can you reach? And it's like, well, this is the world we're in now. So actually, the music notation is important. So it's not to completely sell music notation and reading short. It's important in that world. But in the world that Chris was talking about earlier, certainly it's like, if you're learning music, learning tunes, it's like, it's an aural art form. It's an aural discipline, for sure. Rant over.
Awesome. I love it. I love it. This is great. So a couple of other questions. Kirsten Kempthorne says, do you enjoy scales and scales practice? And maybe as a subsequent thing for me, how's your scales practice changed over the years?
Chris?
I mean, scales are like the building blocks of harmony. And if you can understand your way around scales and understand how they work and like learn the relationship of intervals and how they all relate, I think it's great, you know? I think anyone that's a horn player, you should be able to play all of your scales and start on the lowest note of your horn up to the highest note in your working range and be able to like run up and down your scales. I think that's a good goal. Years ago, I remember like there's a great keyboardist and musician artist that has been a mentor and like a, you know, musical idol of a lot of the Snarky Puppy members. When we were in Texas, living in Texas, Justin and I in Dallas, this guy named Bernard Wright. He one time, he was in Denton because we were playing a gig, and he came over to my house to hang out a little bit, and I like took a lesson, and he played with Michael Brecker a lot back in the day. And he was like, you need to be able to play your scales from your lowest note, any key, but just start on the lowest note of your horn up to the highest note and back down. And then, so he had this thing where I would like go around the cycle of force, and I would just start on my lowest note of the horn. So like a saxophone would be B flat. And just depending on the key, I just kept going up and down and then moving to the next scale when I got back down to the bottom note or the top note, you know, things like that. Really fun exercises just to take you out of the norm of like playing from root to root. Another thing that I think is really helpful too is learning how to play scales in different groupings. So you can land on strong consonant tones, 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, and going up and so forth, but on like a downbeat or different things like that, you know, grouping them in 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, things like that, you know, just not just always just like, okay, I did my scales root to root. I'm good. Now I can go on to that other thing. You know, when I was 15, it was like, I got to get my scales out of the way so I can have fun and do this other stuff. But over time you learn like the importance of these things and how like, it's like a building block, so to say. So Justin, what are your thoughts?
Man, I love all that. I love all that so much, what you just said. And yeah, you were saying like landing on like guide notes, but also like considering just different groupings. Like if you want to take it to like a different place, it's like, yeah, say I'm going to like put it in groups of fives or groups of sevens, or like create some sort of like parameter within which to work in the scale. So like Chris said, you're not just running the scale. The way I like to treat scales now, always with a metronome, because like, especially if you're running at any sort of velocity, so you make sure that there's no sort of like bull crap happening in the fingers, you know, make sure everything is happening super smooth. And then also I use it as like a vehicle to like check my articulation and sort of set my embouchure. That's kind of what I'm working on these days, is like really setting my embouchure. And the idea, maybe not, it may be a little controversial, but it's sort of like starting with the tongue here, like as if you're holding the air back, and it's acting like a sort of release valve. Not always like the least frowned upon way to look at things, but that's kind of where I'm at right now. That's what I'm working on to sort of set my embouchure and stuff. And scales are great for that. So But obviously, yeah, know all your scales top to bottom.
I think it's also important to like think about how you're using that metronome to practice, because there were so many years that I would just always have it on downbeats, you know, put it on like, okay, I'm going to play my scales 16th notes at 80 or 62 or something like that. But then over time, like I noticed, I like some friends of mine that have like really good time. And when they're playing with a drummer that might be like doing some polyrhythmic things, and I might feel like the carpet's pulled out from underneath me, the rug's pulled out. I'm like, where's the downbeat? So I realized that I was like, the metronome became a crutch for me because I was always using it on the downbeat. So I started like slowing the metronome way down, or getting a metronome that, you know, you can put it at like quarter note is 37, but that 37 is going to be the and of four. But I'm going to do these groupings of scales, but I'm going to make sure it lines up where that click is on the and of four or beat two. You know, a good one to start is be like, make it like beat two, you know, or beat four, just something, start simple. But just take yourself out of the comfort zone of always just having this click, click, downbeat, downbeat. Because music doesn't exist as like downbeat, downbeat. The minute you start traveling in different parts of the world, people feel music in different ways and group the beat in different ways. And the downbeat is not always the most prominent beat, you know. So it's important to just, if you're practicing, to make sure you're taking yourself out of your comfort zone and trying some challenging new things at a slow tempo. I said my piece.
Love it. Okay. We have a whole heap of more questions, but unfortunately we've come down to the last question of this Q&A session. So for both of you guys, I know. It's just
getting warmed up over here. It's 1:30 a.m.
Yeah. We're going from rant hour to luxury hour, so I thought we might just put
Love
a pin
it.
In it. Okay.
Bray, you're like the best MC of all time, man.
Incredible.
I'm glad you think that you're the only one who thinks that, though. So, okay.
I'm starting a fan club.
It'll be my one social media presence. So, very last question from Joel Sanchez Khan. How do you guys generally approach playing solos in Snarky? And have you gotten to a point where you eschew, I know it's that C7 question again, but how do you eschew theory and simply go by ear or by like flow state kind of thing?
Well, in terms of soloing, I mean, we try to keep it democratic. And I mean, it certainly people have their tunes in the band that they solo on, but it doesn't necessarily mean like this is my solo tonight, or you know, it's there's not any ownership over solos. But in terms of like the idea of eschewing the theory, it's kind of what we were just talking about, is like we're talking about getting past the theory. It's having such a strong grasp on the theory that it's sort of seeped into your subconscious. It's seeped into your vernacular. You're like when you're communicating, I mean, it's 1:30 in the morning for me. I'm sort of grasping at straws a little bit, but in terms of like communicating and having a conversation with people, you're not really thinking about the rules of grammar. That's where you're trying to get with your music and with improvisation and with soloing. It's like, you want to be communicating on the bandstand. You don't want to be thinking about, okay, what's the next chord change? Okay, 2-5-1, now we're going to B, now we're going to D flat. You want to get past that, but the only way to get past that is to deal with it. You need to deal with it on a real level, and you need to have experience both on an analytical level and a performance and real life level. And you get more and more comfortable with these things, and these things need to sort of seep in to your ear. And I think that's there's no substitute for experience, I guess I would say. You just have to do it a lot. Anybody that you respect on any instrument has spent so much time dealing with their instrument, probably from a very young age, usually. They put the time in. There's no shortcut. That's it.
Yeah, maybe I could add a little bit to that too. I'm totally with all of that. I think another thing too, like I try to really be in touch with like what's going on in that given moment and how can I be in the moment and adding to it. And conversing. So like Justin said, you know, communicating, like, and music is a language, like he was saying, you know, not thinking about the chords and grammar or so to say, you know, like to get it to where it can just be expression, but that requires time spent with that music or that harmony or that rhythm or all of it put together. But, another thing I really like to think about too, when I'm, playing, every venue is different and the acoustics of venues can be different and what might have worked 2 days ago might not work today. And I really try to like be in that moment and touch into that space and not be thinking about like, you know, the future or the past and just really be in the moment. And that might be like, you know, one night we might be playing in like a classical concert hall that's very like it's very live. And I have to be like a little gentle with what I choose to do with my sounds or the way I play the horn. And then the flip side of that, we could be in a space that can be a little dead, like a small rock room or something that's loud. And what I played that I might be feeling like I like to play and finesse this, it doesn't work in a space like that. So I really try to take care to be aware of my surroundings and my settings. You know, if the crowd is really loud and they're talkative, it's like, okay, cool. Well, if you're not listening, well, I'm going to do some stuff that might make you listen. Maybe it works, maybe it doesn't. But again, it's just like that experience, like that Justin mentioned, you know, I think it's something to consider. But just really being in the moment and making sure that you've like prepared for that moment in the past, you know, and or just doing the things so you have that freedom of expression, you know. And some days it's there, and other days it's like, oof, you know, there's always tomorrow, hopefully.
Excellent. I don't know if I'm frozen. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
I can hear you.
Oh, good. Okay. So my computer monitor's frozen, but, oh, excellent. Everything else works though. I'm thinking.
Oh yeah, we're here.
Anyway. Okay. So, thanks everyone for coming to this, Q&A and live webinar. Thank you to Chris and Justin. You guys are amazing. Thank you for answering all the questions so honestly. Look, we appreciate a good rant here in Australia, so we're very, very happy for you to come back anytime.
Well, we appreciate you guys. Thank you so much for setting this up for us.
Yeah.
This is super fun.
It's super fun indeed. Excellent. Thanks, guys.
Excellent. All right, guys. Well, thanks again for turning up for this live webinar. For more information on our products, you can visit au.yamaha.com. And once again, thank you, Chris and Justin, for the live webinar. We're out.